As the days have gone on, it has increased in numbers by the fadl and karam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've got brothers from America, South Africa, Denmark, Birmingham, Scotland. We've got them coming from everywhere, alhamdulillah, with the fadl and karam of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this masjid a beacon of nur for the whole world, and may Allah give us the means and to be able to facilitate all these people. Inshallah, whatever you're about to hear, don't just listen, but make this intention that whatever you're going to hear, you are going to do amal upon it and act upon it. And also learn what displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then to make a firm intention to refrain and abstain from such things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased with. Jazakallah khair. Thank you.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد In this life sometimes a person goes through difficulties, problems. It can be family matter, it can be business matter, it can be other matters. How that problem is normally solved by the fadl of Allah is that a person gets an idea in mind, a thought, an idea comes in mind, and by acting upon that idea he solves the problem. That's how, for example, if the electric is not working, the electrician is going to diagnose where the fault is. When he can't figure it out, an idea comes and then maybe it gets solved. Similarly, a doctor, a physician, he checks a person, he can't cure them. They think about what's wrong with him, what's wrong with him, and then idea comes and they put into practice, the person becomes cured. Similarly, is a person who is struggling with wealth, attaining wealth, an idea of business comes into his mind and he acts upon it and the business becomes a success. He becomes successful. So, similar is the case with our purpose of life and with our spiritual life and with our life of dunya and akhirah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's point of view. Many of us are stuck sometime. It's as though we have come to a dead end and we are not getting any further. Yes, alhamdulillah, you have believed and you are Muslim, but then many people are stuck at a particular level. Some are trapped into an addiction, some into any other sin, some just actually heedlessness. Ye ab logon ko upar bhejein, andar na bhejein, phir ye garmi ho jayegi. Some through other things actually. So how to unlock and remove this deadlock? So regarding that, I was mentioning, sharing with you some of the blessed sayings of Sayyidina Abdul Aziz Dabbaw, rahmahullah. Why we mention the sayings of the Anbiya, Awliya, Siddiqeen? Because they are experts in that field. Very simply, why you take your car to the car mechanic when you can see, when you have the manual yourself? He might not even have the manual of your car, but still that very thick manual you have, you cannot actually fix the car. Same is the case that why people go to doctors, books are there, everything is there. Why people go to lawyers when they know about law, they can find about law. It's just expertise they are going after, basically. Because that person might have experienced it again and again, he will be expert. So in worldly matter, worldly matters, that we go to these people for their expert advice. Expert being physician, being so. These awliya, Allah, like Sayyidina Abdulaziz Dabbagh and many of the pious, righteous, they are expert in the field of that solving problems for people who have been trapped by shaitan, who has actually been confused, who've lost the purpose, because they have expertise. So sometimes there is one idea, there is one thought and one saying solves so much problem that if by self that person reads whole of the Quran, he might not be able to get that, because he don't have that understanding, that depth. So I'll carry on. As I mentioned, Sayyidina Abdulaziz Dabbagh rahmahullah in Ramadan Mubarak, regarding Ramadan, he said, like you are in the month of Ramadan, one should put one's sincere effort to achieve perfection. And Allah Azza wa Jal is looking for one's effort, not whether one has achieved perfection or not. So simply he said that many people are in deadlock because they come towards the religion and spirituality to become perfect, and when they cannot, after years of struggle, they're still doing little bit of bad things and others happening. So they come to the conclusion, we cannot achieve it. We might as well actually just do what the devil says, what the nafs is saying, what other people are doing. We might well do that. But Sayyidina Abdulaziz Dabbagh rahmahullah, he mentioned that as far as the perfection is concerned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking for just the intention. Intention you can make perfect as possible. It doesn't cost any much, it doesn't cost money, and you can make very the best intention to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second thing he said, that Allah azza wa jal is looking at one's effort, not perfection and not results, not actually that you reach the end or not. In other words, if someone says to you that you try to open a business, open a shop, a grocery shop, a takeaway, put the effort into it, have the intention to make profit, even you fail, I will still make you millionaire. Then what hopelessness that person have, what hesitancy, what double thought, what pessimism he should have in mind, because all he's asked to just to open a business and work. And the other person says that even if your business fails, I am going to actually give you millions. Actually, you only have to do your duty. So everyone will open business then, because when they are guaranteed success. So it's very easy really from that point of view to be successful in Akhirah. It's difficult to be successful in dunya. In dunya, there are many people who have spent thousands and thousands of pounds, took credit and are in debt from family, from banks, and they have very good idea, they do advertisement, the companies, but at the end of the day the company goes bust or bankrupt or something goes wrong, the sales are not right, person fails. Now he cannot say to people, please help me, I had a very good intention, I was spending 8 hours in the shop for you, please help me. They'll say, actually that's good for you, we are not going to help. So a person suffers then. That's why some people who made their God dunya and money, then they commit suicide, then they become actually depressed, they become mentally imbalanced because of actually that. Because now they say, think we put everything and we are not getting anything, rather it's loss. Many people come into partnership and the partner runs away with actually the money, the share, and they are left. Like one person said to me, actually, that I am in problem, actually, what's the problem? He said, I did partnership with someone, and said, what happened? He said, I had the money, and but I didn't have the expertise. He had the experience. So we came, I said, I will okay invest money, and I don't have experience, and do you have experience? Let's do business. So I said, what is the problem now? He said, the experience have come to me and money has gone to him. I have become experienced. Tajarba. Tajarba mere paas aa gaya, paise uske paas chale gaye hain. So sometimes things happen like this. So but in akhirah, in regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter how small effort you have done, but with sincerity, Allah Azza wa Jal values it, and He is going to treat you as though you have become successful. Imam Ghazali mentioned in Bani Israel, there was famine and drought, no rain, people were dying. This person was not a rich person, but he was a pious man. He was going along the desert and he saw sand dunes, sand mountains, like dunes, which you can see hills made of sand. Sand is accumulated together, dunes, big sand dunes. So if you look from far away, it looks like a heap of grains and wheat. So in his mind came, I wish I had this mountain of food, I would have at least spent on the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I don't have, what can I do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent wahi on the prophet of that time, that go and tell this person, I have written in his book of deeds the reward of as though he has spent whole mountain in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because I look at the intention of the people. So to deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most easy. So Sayyidina Abdulaziz Dabar said, one should work on the level of spiritual fasting and ibadah as best as he can, disengage from dunya. But as I also mentioned the other day, he says, not to be too self-critical and judge oneself, like I mentioned yesterday. It's good to criticize yourself, but if you are so much critical, you so much judge yourself, that actually it makes you inactive, it makes you lethargic, it makes you lazy, it makes you pessimistic, then that is the wrong way. So he said, don't judge, meaning judging, meaning that you don't make decision for yourself, I am bad person, I'll go in hell, or I will go in Jannah. Don't judge. Judgment is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let Allah judge you on the day of judgment. There will be people coming on the day of judgment, they will think they are going in hell. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, a servant of Allah, a person will be called to Allah, because everyone, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, will be presented in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, alone, individually. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, without interpreter and without any wakil or solicitor or anything like this. No interpreter, no wakil. Directly you will have to be face to face with Allah azza wa jal. And that is, even Anbiya alayhim salam fear that. Even awliya fear that, to actually face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah azza wa jal will call a person from the creation. There will be billions and trillions and zillions people, jinnat in the plain of Hashar, and they will be looking. Allah Azza wa Jal will call one person and will cover him. Cover him meaning that people will not be able to see him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him, have you done this sin? Mention a sin from his book of deeds. He say, yes. Have you done this? Yes. Have you done this? Yes, sin. He's mentioning sin after sin. Now, that person will think, I am now basically going to hell. Allah Azza wa Jalla is questioning me and mentioning my sins. But because that person have had sincere and he had asked forgiveness or done some good deeds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, no injustice will be done to you. Today, I am like I covered your sins in dunya. These sins I'm mentioning, I did not show people because you were somewhat sincere with me. I didn't show it to people, and today I have hidden you from the creation. So between me and you, I have forgiven and changed your sins into virtue. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that person will say, Ya Allah, I have some more sins as well which you have not counted. When he will see they are being changed into virtues, he say, we might actually get those changed as well. So when the people will be waiting in the hashar, they would be, and this person will come up with the certificate, and they would think Allah has really blessed him. He is a wali. He is actually awliya Allah, mashallah. He's got the certificate of Jannah. They don't know he was the worst kind of sinner, but Allah had his mercy on. So that's what I'm saying to you, that don't judge yourself. Leave the judgment to Allah and hope in the mercy of Allah. And that's it. And don't judge. Don't be too much self-critical. Yes, criticize yourself, but not all the time. I am this, I am this. Criticism is beneficial when you have positive result from it. And when it is keeping you down, actually then it is not. He said that if one falls short of achieving the goal, then one should seek forgiveness and do not worry about any loss that occurred. But one should stand up and carry on the next day. To Rasulullah ﷺ, one person came, Ya Rasulullah ﷺ, my tongue has destroyed me. Zuban ne mujhe tabah kar diya hai. I cannot control it. I try, but... So Rasulullah ﷺ said, if you cannot control the tongue, why don't you do astaghfar with the tongue? I do astaghfar 100 times a day. So Rasulullah ﷺ taught, this means that a person who practices astaghfar with the tongue, he will get the control of the tongue. His tongue will actually become better because the tongue is doing astaghfar. Astaghfar, there is a benefit. He said, if you try to achieve a goal, if you cannot reach, ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and carry on the next day. One should not become despondent if one falls. As we have seen many times in the past, a person puts efforts to derive benefit of the day, but an obstacle may come along and they fall short. Then they feel dejected and a few more days passes and the days gets wasted before they make an attempt again. He says that one, sometimes, because what will happen is when you're too self-critical, for example, you are doing okay, but after 2 days, you have sinned again. And you put effort, something happened, shaitan misled you, or the nafs misled you, whatever happened, you've sinned. Sayyidina Abdulaziz Dabbagh is saying that you feel then dejected, you feel bad, but by feeling bad, you stay in that sin, and without tawbah for many days pass. Many days pass, you stay in that state. That was not actually for you, so you are actually being harmed. So more days passes and the days gets wasted before they make an attempt again. While I mentioned the other day, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in Sahih Hadith that when a person commits a sin, he said until 6 sa'at, until a particular time, it's not written even for a person. So it's no use waiting for days because then it will be written and it can harm you. But as soon as, it's like people who are bitten by a snake. A very poisonous snake comes and bites you, stings you. If the treatment is available, maybe you have 5-6 minutes. In 5-6 minutes, half an hour, you are treated. The poison can stop and you are safe. Alhamdulillah, nothing happens. And you have a cure. So you have a cure here of someone gives you, if you are bitten by a snake, this is just inject. Just put this injection and you will be fine. Poison will not affect you. But this person, what he does, snake comes, and bites him. Oh, I've been bitten by a snake. Oh, what shall I do now? Oh, I'm going to die. Not doing, waiting hours and hours and hours, and one day, it will pass 2 days. He will die that eventually. The wisdom was that there Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you sometimes, someone has cancer, someone has AIDS. There are early stages sometimes. If you get treatment, it just becomes completely well, 100%. So similar is sin as well. Sin is a poison and shaitan is the snake. Shaitan is a symbolically snake, sometimes represents shaitan. So shaitan is like the snake. And sin is like poison. So he stings you, meaning you do sin. Now Allah has given you the cure, antidote, tawbah to you. If you apply the injection of tawbah, no matter how big the sin is, the poison gets neutralized. Finish. You are healthy again next hour and start again, alhamdulillah. But if you say, oh, what has happened? And wait there and criticize why I was lazy, I shouldn't have been in this place, why did I kill the snake in first place? If you carry on thinking like this, you will actually fail. So the Prophet ﷺ said that for a certain number of minutes or time, the poison of the sin does not affect. So do. That's what Sayyidina Abdul Izzaman. One should work as though, now the next important thing, listen very carefully. He said, one should work as though one is building a palace of closeness of Allah, putting brick by brick every day to make a palace of closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, one should see the closeness of Allah is a big palace and you are working brick by brick. Don't become demotivated that actually you don't have anything. Every palace, house is built brick by brick. So you are putting one brick, second brick, third brick, fourth brick. Then the wall starts to go forth. That's how the course of Tariqah Muhammadiyya is designed, that every tick is like a brick. You are putting a brick, 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 and slowly, slowly done. One should not leave the effort even if he is putting crosses on the sheet. Again and again, as we do not rely on ourselves nor our efforts, but we seek forgiveness for all our shortcomings for not observing as we should do. So he said, if you fail, if you keep on making mistakes, still actually keep on getting up. So he said, we show our helplessness to Allah. Oh Allah, we are helpless. We've done whatever we could. We show your humbleness to Allah Ta'ala. In reality, only really on rely upon Him to deliver actually you from this, from meaning the punishment. So he mentioned this nasiha in one of the regarding Ramadan. See, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned in a hadith of the Sahih hadith, he said that Allah had a creation, and this is, I'm just explaining you this hadith. Allah had creation which did not do sin, like angels, other creation, they not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then created jinn and human beings so that they sin and they will ask forgiveness and they have freedom of choice. The purpose of Allah is that so that we do by our freedom. So the Prophet ﷺ, to give hope and mention reality, he said that if all people would have become sinless of the human beings and jinns, Allah still would destroy the earth because it doesn't fulfill the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the angels are sufficient. He said that if all people will know, no one will actually do any disobedience, Allah will destroy the earth and He will replace with such people that who will commit sins but then ask forgiveness. So Allah Azza wa Jalla likes people doing tawbah to Him, people asking forgiveness, because if no one sinned, no one asked maghfirah, the rahmah of Allah, the quality of tawwab, the quality of forgiveness doesn't manifest anywhere. It still remains hidden. So person is not destroyed. So no one is going to hell because of sins. people will go in hell because of not repenting. Not repenting. Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Though that one, the one who does not do tawbah, he is the actual zalim. Sins can happen from everyone. Rasulullah said, كُلُّ بَنِي Adam, that all the children of Adam do mistakes and sins. So you should focus not the why you are sinning only, but focus more on tawbah, focus more on forgiveness, focus more on turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and inshallah the path is actually very, very, it becomes much easier for you. Jazakumullah khairan jaza. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. MashaAllah.